When my dad turned 40, my mom threw him a blowout party. I'm talking tent in the backyard with more than 50 guests, some of which were surprise visitors he hadn't seen in a decade. She made a slideshow of his best and funniest pictures, had my uncle write a roast of him. Just an over-the-top night all about him. It was a big deal. There was just one problem. My dad doesn't like big parties or surprises. Oops. Now, don't get me wrong. He liked the party and loved that my mom went through all the trouble for him. As an introvert, he would have just preferred something a little quieter. Maybe just the immediate family, a handful of close friends, grilling some food, playing horseshoes, having a nice, laid-back time. That would have been my dad's ideal birthday. Fast forward 11 months, and it's time for my mom's 40th birthday. Does my dad rent a giant tent, fly in long-lost friends? Not exactly. After a week at the beach, the family spent the day at my aunt's house, maybe 10, 12 of us, lounging around her pool as my dad pampered her with drinks and food whenever she asked. It was a beautifully relaxing day. There was just one problem. My mom lives for a party and has never met a crowd she couldn't have fun with. Did she have a bad birthday? Absolutely not. She got a whole week at the beach, time to spend with her sister and immediate family. Really, who doesn't love lounging in the sun while someone waits on them? It's just, you know, as an extreme extrovert, she would have just preferred something maybe a little louder. Maybe, you know, just her 9 brothers and sisters and their spouses and their kids, and 50 or more people she knew once upon a time, dancing and having to talk so loud of the music that you're exhausted the next day. You know, something small like that. That would have been my mom's ideal birthday. What I find so interesting about these stories, and really what's downright hilarious now that they've been married nearly 35 years, is that they each got each other exactly what they themselves wanted, but the complete opposite of what the actual recipient wanted. They treated the other how they wanted to be treated. Which, really, isn't that what we've always been taught? The golden rule, right? Treat others the way you want to be treated. More biblically, do to no one what you yourself hate. Do to others what you would have them do to you. That's exactly what they did. Which, if you think about it, given the circumstances of my parents, presents an interesting question. Might there be a flaw in this logic? Might we be called to do more than simply treat others the way we want to be treated, but to actually treat them the way they want to be treated? You see, embedded in the logic of the golden rule is the assumption that we all want the same things. And I think that's largely the case in the way that Tobit and Jesus use these words biblically. Treat others with love, mercy, justice, and peace, foundational principles of God that all creatures desire. In a general, broad sense, that's exactly what my parents did. But when we get to the specifics of what it means to love, what it means to show mercy, each of us has slightly different needs, slightly different love languages, so to speak. If you were to give either of my sisters a brand new car, shiny interior, great sound system, powerful engine, they would love it. What an incredible gift to give someone a car to show that you love them. Unless, of course, you're a Franciscan friar with a vow of poverty trying to renounce worldly possessions and live simply. If someone were to give me a brand new car, I'm pretty sure I would see that as a burden. The love behind the gift, the intention? Yes, that would obviously come through and it would mean a lot, just like the love my parents felt with their respective parties. But the execution? Well, it would be hard not to be a little disappointed. Your gift is really more about you than it is about me. As we look out into our world, but really even within our church, it becomes immensely clear that there are people who are quite different from us, people who want different things, who have different needs, whether because of religion, gender, race, culture, sexual orientation, or simply personal preference, our immediate values are not the same. How do we act in these situations? How do we interact with those who are, in many ways, fundamentally different from us? Some would suggest that we treat them the way that we want to be treated, that we can't change our values just because someone doesn't accept them. We are who we are, and we have to stand on truth, which makes a lot of sense. So what does that look like? Well, it looks like saying Merry Christmas to everyone, even Jews and Muslims, because we're Christian. I mean, it's Christmas whether they accept it or not, right? It means referring to gay couples as married, emphasizing the quotes because our church doesn't recognize the union to be valid. Why would we call it something that it isn't, right? It means eating a peanut butter and jelly sandwich in the break room at work every day, even when some of your coworkers have a severe peanut allergy. Why should I have to change the way I eat just because someone else can't digest it? Because they'll die. That's why. And that's sort of the problem with this extreme, I'm not gonna change my values for others approach. Sometimes treating people the way that we want to be treated makes for a funny story about your 40th birthday, no harm, no foul. But sometimes it can be significantly hurtful to others. And that's sort of the opposite of what the Golden Rule is about, isn't it? Saying happy holidays to someone of another religion doesn't mean we renounce our faith and adopt theirs. It's simply an attempt to acknowledge another person's experience. Calling a gay couple married without additional commentary isn't an endorsement of their life any more than calling what Episcopalians do on Sunday communion. We know it's not the same as what we believe, but we don't have to go out of our way to belittle another because of it. And obviously, making changes to our diet, temporarily taking away small choices in our life so that others don't die, seems to be a no-brainer. If something could potentially kill another person, we should be willing to sacrifice a little of our freedom and endure a small amount of inconvenience. Is this to say that we go to the other end of the extreme and become doormats, doing things that undermine our values out of a sense of hospitality? Of course not. No one expects you to say the prayers of another faith, attend a wedding that is against your values, give up peanut butter for the rest of your life. You are still compelled to live as a Christian, no matter who you encounter. But that's sort of the point. Act as a Christian. We don't treat people with love and respect only if they're like us, or only if they have the same values as us. What does Jesus say? Love your enemies. It's pretty difficult to love someone if all you're doing is thinking about how you want to be treated, if you're simply projecting your values onto others. Listen to someone different from you. Try to understand why they do what they do. Call them by the name they prefer, the title that suits them. Go out of your way to make them feel comfortable and welcomed by you. Are these not the things that Jesus did? He went among the prostitutes and the tax collectors, not to adopt their promiscuous or greedy life, but to encounter the person for who they were. As his followers, we must do the same. Do to no one what you yourself hate. Do to others whatever you would have them do to you. See the person before you, not as a set of values that you abhor or a threat to your life, but as a child of God, just looking to find a home. And who knows, just like Jesus, if we adopt more of an attitude of compassion and understanding rather than judgment and skepticism, we might just find ourselves evangelizing our new brothers and sisters in Christ.